Yeah. So these are the three things that you see on your screen. These are the three major events that you should know. These were the three things that were ruling the scenario while Chaucer was writing. It was the Hundred Years' War, the Black Death, and the Peasants' Revolt. Now, we'll be first talking about the Hundred Years' War. It's a very long time. It's 100 years. But in the olden days, obviously, there was more time given to these wars because battles, war, and passion, and winning, being victorious, expanding the territory was the only thought that people had in their minds. So 100 years is not a very long time if you see for the people in those days, because in Europe also we see the Battle of Troy running for 10 long years only because of this lady Helen. So this 100 years war was a conflict between France and England basically, and King Harold was the king of England at that time, and in France we had William the Conqueror. Now, William the Conqueror had conquered England. See, England was not all powerful right from the beginning. It was like us. It was like India, a victim, because the Normans attacked, Saxons, Jutes, and all came to England and they bought their dialect, and England was fragmented. England was also attacked and ruled. England was also dominated. England was also colonized, we can say that, and that is how French came into England. So it was France that attacked England. It was William the Conqueror who attacked King Harold. And because William the Conqueror had this intention of combining France and England and ruling both these territories together, this was the reason of the war that was fought. And this war was fought from 1337 to 1453, and it was between England and France. Basically, you have to remember the war happened because of land holdings of England by France. William the Conqueror became the King of England. That is what we call as Norman Conquest, that you remember it so by heart, 1066 AD. We all remember that it is the Norman Conquest that happened in 1066 AD. But what exactly is this Norman Conquest? So Norman Conquest is when the Normans, that is the French people, attacked the England, the place of England. This is Norman Conquest. So William the Conqueror became the King of England in 1066 AD. And he united England with France and he started ruling both the areas, France as well as England, which was not accepted by the other future kings of England. Obviously, they wanted a separate England. They did not want to be ruled by France. And this is what the second point, if you see in the PPT, is sense of identity. Because of the suppression comes the sense of identity that I want to be free. So sense of identity developed, and this is where English started gaining importance. This is where they thought that we should have a separate language of our own and French language should go off the stage. So during this war, a sense of English identity develops and people completely refuse to adapt all what is foreign, all what is French, all the French customs. They stopped adapting and using the French customs anymore, and they just wanted a language that they call their own, that is English. So this is where English language was given importance. You need to remember that during this 100 years of war, the sense of identity became so strong. See, when you have that willpower and determination, you finally win the fight. But when you are hopeless and downtrodden, you kind of lose. So now these English people are developing a sense of identity. So they, because of this determination that had come already, they started winning some battles. And they won three battles against France. And this is when they started getting victorious. And the reason why they won, this is there on the screen. The reason, these are the three battles that England won. Battle of Crecy, Battle of Poitiers, and Battle of Agincourt. All these three are places where these battles were fought. So these are the names of the battles on the names of the places where these battles were fought, and years are also given. So these were the three battles that the English won against France. And also you should know that they adopted some different kind of technique. They adopted the long bowmen method, which is a kind of archery that the English used. And the French used a short distance bow method that is called as the crossbow method. In the crossbow method, the arrows don't go long. But in the long bow method, arrows go long. So this is what a different kind of technique that English people started using. And this is how they won these three battles. Then the second very important thing after 100 years war that you should remember during one thing, let me tell you that you are studying about the age of Chaucer, and you should know that Chaucer himself fought in this war. Chaucer was one writer who belonged to the three periods, the French, the Italian, English. He was from all the three periods. So you should know that Chaucer himself was a part of this 100 years war, and you will see his text talking about all the three happenings that were happening at that time. Now we come to Black Death, that is so relatable to all of us right now in the COVID pandemic. So that time also there was a plague that had come, and it was from 1347 to 1351. It is referred to as the plague or Black Death, and this plague was particularly spread by rats. And the problem was, a person who contracted this disease died within 5 days. So due to this, 1/3 of the population of Europe died, and people started questioning the healing power of God. People started questioning, where is God? Where is the clergy? Where is the church? Why are we all dying? So that is, there is no God. So people started moving away from God to atheism. And so here, this atheism kind of belief gave or paved a way for science to come in. So religion is sidetracked, and hence science is coming in, because God is not ready to answer the question of the death of so many people. People are losing their near and dear ones. So people started questioning God and the priest of the church, and this led to the development of science. So medical sciences and education is one good thing that was happening. People believed that science will give them progress. So this is the second very important event that happened during this time. So you see, Europe is growing cold now, and England is at the good side now after winning wars, and the Black Death also affected England, but it affected Europe more. Then coming to the third thing that happened in this era was the Peasants' Revolt. This also is relatable to all of us right now. We are also having this wave. You know what a wave is? Wave is when it, how does a wave come? It goes up and then it goes down, it goes up, it goes down, right? So similarly, the Peasants' Revolt is kind of a wave that you will continuously see, that Peasants' Revolt is coming, and then peasants are silent for a particular time, and again peasants will start revolting. So Peasants' Revolt also comes in waves, like the COVID pandemic. We are seeing that the second wave has begun. So it will, you will feel that it's all now okay. The pandemic is getting over, and suddenly you will hear of cases. So this is the second wave that is coming. So Peasants' Revolt also since then has come in waves. And today also we are suffering with a wave of Peasants' Revolt. We are dealing with this. Today, in this particular, if you're watching news, then you should be knowing about the Farmers' Revolt that was happening. And a few days back, we had two days back, I guess, we had this Maharashtra closed, and it affected India also. So we see these things happening since then, since the Chaucer's time until now. Even today, we are having these things coming back to us in waves. Pandemic, Black Death, that was caused by rats, but this is caused by we don't know what. There are so many people, so many opinions to COVID. So, but the wave of the disease has come again. peasants' revolt also, the wave has come again. So let us talk about this third thing that dominated the scene. It was peasants' revolt that came in 1381. It was led by two important people. You need to remember their names, Wat Tyler and John Ball. And there was a huge population decline already due to the Black Death. And lower classes are the people who always suffer. Government is needing funds to treat the people who are in hospitals, to treat the people who are dying, to let the people come out of the Black Death. So government needs funds. And where will these funds come from? The funds will come from the taxes paid by the commoners, the lower classes. And who are these lower classes? They are the farmers. So the peasants were unnecessarily taxed, and that is why this discontent, this injustice gave a rise to the revolt that happened. So peasants were basically paying heavy taxes to fund the Hundred Years' War. So they were unhappy about the entire scenario. They even captured the Tower of London, which is a very prominent place in England, in London. Taxes were lifted, but still you will see that the peasants were oppressed by the aristocracy. And because of this peasants' revolt, there were many losses that England and Europe together suffered. But we see that the English language is gaining importance, English becoming the language of court in 1362, language of parliament in 1363, and language of school teaching in 1386. And this is how English finally comes on stage and French is completely removed. You need to remember that the sense of identity had already come. Because of the sense of identity, English started winning wars, winning battles. Then this Black Death also came, because of which the population of Europe declined, and now it became more easy for the English to survive and win wars, win battles. And so they developed their own language. French was removed. They gave prominence to English language. English becomes the language of court in 1362. English becomes the language of parliament in 1363 and the language of school teaching in 1386. And finally, we see that French is completely removed. So this is how French and Latin are removed and English is accepted as the language. So these are the three major things that happened in the age of Chaucer. You need to remember. First is the Hundred Years' War. Second is the Black Death. And the third is the Peasants' Revolt. These are three major events that shaped the entire era of Chaucer. And also, if you look at, I know that somebody else is going to talk about Chaucer, but if you look closely at Chaucer, you should know that Chaucer is a personality whose life can be divided into three ages. The French influence, he also lived in the Italian period, he also lived in the English period. And he's a great observer. His observation skills you can very well see in his work, Canterbury Tales. So that's all I can speak on Age of Chaucer. I hope you have enjoyed the session. I hope you have followed everything about the Age of Chaucer. Thank you very much for giving me this time.
Thank you, Manav ma'am. Actually, there was a...
Now?
Yes, it is getting...
Yes,
busy.
Yes, it
yeah.
is.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much. So yeah, first of all, I would like to thank Manat for giving such a wonderful description of the age of Chaucer. And now after this brings us to this section of particular session, which will be about Geoffrey Chaucer, Geoffrey Chaucer's biography. And in biography, we are going to look about where he was born, when he was born, about his family, and about his occupation, profession, and about his contemporaries, about everything else which is related to Chaucer. And then we will move on to his most famous work, which is Canterbury Tales, followed by previous year RTC and previous year questions. So for RTC and questions, I have not shared all the RTCs, but I've just taken a sample of RTC and a question which I have written or I've prepared, so which we will see in coming slides. So moving on, let's begin the session by looking at what other poets has remarked about Chaucer. So these are two remarks which is given by Thomas Hudson and John Dryden about Chaucer.
So as Manat has already mentioned in her session, in her section, that, you know, when Chaucer came, when, you know, it was a transition period. So England was going through a lot of transitions. So, however, the entire century gets named after this massive figure, Geoffrey Chaucer. He was described as the first of our really national poets by Thomas Hudson. And and he was also considered, and we still continue to consider him as the father of English poetry, which is given by John Ryder. So now many historians consider Chaucer as the real starting point of English literature. So now we have already seen why Chaucer is considered as the opening moment of English literature. She has explained, and I will also explain in coming slides. So let's see that he lived under the rule of three monarchs. He lived from 1340 to 1400. So now when we talk about the opening movement of English literature, we also need to understand the time period in which Chaucer lived. So he had a very rare opportunity of having lived under the rule of three monarchs. And who are these three monarchs? We will just see. So he was born in during 1340s, 1340, 42, 43. So when he was born in this time, it was the reign of Edward the King III, and it was during his lifetime that Richard II succeeded in 1377. Now, who is Richard II? Richard II is grandson of Edward the III. And why he got the crown? Because his father, who is known as the Black Prince, died even before when King Edward the III died. So you can, you know, have that connection, and this is the way you can remember, like how Richard is connected to Edward. And then he also witnessed two major events, the revolution of 1399, obviously including the deposition of Richard II and foundation of Lancastrian dynasty. And he died in 1400, the year after the accession of Henry IV. So this is a very brief introduction towards the life of Chaucer in terms of the social and political history. And let me come back to the slide. So why I said that Chaucer is the opening movement of English literature, because we will see in coming slides also, and in the content also, that Chaucer was a person who had a lot of opportunity to travel. He had got great exposure. So in that terms, he was able to articulate his writings in a way which is, you know, which is understood by everyone. So he started writing in English, and when and why he started writing in English, we will just see right now. So now moving on, if we look into a bit detail into the life of Chaucer, we saw that he belongs to the Middle English period, which is rightfully known as Morning Star of the Renaissance. He was born in London into a fairly well-to-do family. His father, John Chaucer, was a wine merchant who supplied the cellars to King Edward III. Now you can see how it was very easy for Geoffrey Chaucer to enter the court, because obviously his father had some relationships where, you know, he can put his son there. And we know very little about his childhood, except that he studied at St. Paul's Cathedral, where he was influenced by the writings of Virgil and Ovid. And at a very young age. Now, if I assume that he was born in 1340, he was only 17 years old when he was appointed as a page. Now, a page is a young boy in service of a knight. So he was appointed as a page to Elizabeth. Elizabeth is Countess of Ulster and wife of Lionel. Now, Lionel is again King Edward III's third son. He was the third son of King Edward III. And at the age of 90, like after 2 years, he traveled France and with Prince Lionel and the English army. And the English army was taken prisoner, but soon ransomed. Now, Chaucer was highly valuable in the royal family, which we can ascertain from the fact that King Edward III paid a ransom of about £16 for his release. Now, £16, like in that century, I think it's a huge amount. And if I have to believe the historians who have recorded the, you know, buying capacity of £16, you can, if you spend a single pound, you would be able to sustain, an ordinary man would be able to sustain for 6 months. So just imagine that he paid such a huge amount just to get Chaucer back on ransom. So you can identify, you can just assume that what kind of, you know, how much he was favorite of King Edward or how much he was valued in that particular court. So coming to 1366, he traveled to Spain, and after returning from there, he married Philippa Royet, who was also attendant to the Queen. Now, we don't have many details about his domestic life since historians were not able to record it, as many of the things were not available. So if I compare, you know, the information which we have about Geoffrey Chaucer with the information we have about William Langland, we will see that we don't have anything about on William Langland. So now, why it is possible to have, so, you know, whatever details we have about Geoffrey Chaucer was because he was working in court. He was an official worker. So you can get some details and some, you know, written details from these kinds of documents. Okay, so in 1369, Chaucer was asked by John of Gaunt. Now, John of Gaunt was also born in the same year when Chaucer was born. He was also born in 1340. He was also son of King Edward III. So he asked Chaucer to compose a memorial poem written in English. So this is the first time anyone will compose any poem in English. So he asked him to compose a memorial poem written in English to be recited at the mast for his deceased wife Blanche, Duchess of Lancaster. The result was Chaucer's first work, The Book of Duchess. He also continues to be closely connected with the court and was often sent on diplomatic missions to France, to Italy. So his, like I said before, so his exposure was also quite varied. He had luxurious life and was sent as ambassador to different parts of the country and world as well. So he got to travel a lot, and that exposure really made Chaucer into the man that he was. Now, this is, you know, I have tried to accumulate points which I could possibly on one slide. And if any one of you, if now for those who want to have a detailed look of Chaucer's biography and timeline, I have added a link here. So when I share my PPT with all of you, you just have to go on full screen F11 and F11 view and just click on this link, and you will get all the details starting from the birth of Edward III till 1598, when Canterbury Tales was supposedly published for the first time. Now, just like all the human beings, like Chaucer also had some ups and downs in his life. So like I said before, in how he was sent to Italy on diplomatic missions because he was considered as a fine ambassador to negotiate with the leaders of other countries.